Part 2. June 1935, Philadelphia County, Pennsylvania, USA. America the Beautiful. Music by Samuel A. Ward, lyrics by Catherine Lee Bates. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Chapter 1. After a night of wrestling the heat in the upper boys' dormitory, Mike Flannery nuzzled into his pillow, savoring the cool air that finally drifted through the open windows at the bishop's home for friendless and destitute children. A morning dove cooed, sink faucets dripped, bed springs creaked as the lads shifted and settled in their narrow cots. Through a cobweb of dreams, Mike heard Frankie's distinctive whistle, the last six notes of America the Beautiful, their signal for emergencies. He propped himself on one elbow, rubbed his eyes, and hoped he'd imagined it. Mike heard it again, and the lyrics played in his mind, from sea to shining sea. He flung off his sheet, tiptoed to the second-story window, and looked down. His little brother Frankie stood next to a hydrangea bush, pointing to the oak that hugged the side of the brick building. Mike hurried back to his cot, put on his knickers and shirt, and slipped into his suspenders, being careful not to wake the 19 other boys still asleep in the room. He ran his fingers through what little hair he had left. Yesterday, a barber had donated his services, and Mike's hair was so short that the cowlick above his left eyebrow stood straight up like an exclamation point. It was bad enough to be almost 6 feet tall at 11 years old and have red hair. It was worse to draw attention to it. He pulled on his cap. Barefooted, he tiptoed down the hall and past the door of Mrs. Godfrey, the floor warden. The snoring coming from inside reassured him that she wouldn't budge anytime soon. He opened the stairwell door, closed it behind him, and took the steps two at a time to the landing between floors. At the window, he lifted the sash and stuck his head out. Frankie had already scaled to the tree saddle where the limbs forked. He waved and began to climb upward. Mike couldn't watch. Heights frightened him, and looking straight down made him dizzy. He took a step back and waited, shifting his eyes to the Pennsylvania countryside. Bishop's was only a few hours from Philadelphia by automobile, but it might as well have been in the middle of nowhere for all the cornfields surrounding it. Frankie was across from him now, steadying himself with one hand on an overhead branch and walking tightrope fashion across a limb toward the window. This kid was fearless. Mike held his breath until Frankie swung his leg over the sill and tumbled into the stairwell. Mike helped him stand. "What are you doing up so early? If Mrs. Delancey finds out you left your building before morning bell, she'll tell Pennyweather and you'll get detention in the cellar again." He brushed twigs from Frankie's hair. He'd seen the barber yesterday, too, but he had the younger boy's bowl cut. "I hate it when you come up the tree." "It's emergency," whispered Frankie, his large eyes sincere and insistent. "And I had to climb up. Side doors are still locked, and if you let me in the front door, it'll make too much noise." "What happened?" asked Mike, herding him toward the stairs. Frankie sat on one step, and Mike sat two below, so he wouldn't tower over the kid. There was no mistaking they were brothers. Frankie was a younger version of Mike by 4 years. His hair wasn't as red, though. It was a far more acceptable auburn. They were both fair with freckles, but Frankie had fewer. Although they were tall for their ages, Mike leaned toward gangly, clumsy, and quiet. Frankie was wiry, athletic, and talkative. "Last night, Mrs. Delancey was trying to get us to settle in bed," said Frankie. "Me and some of the boys were acting out and playing hide-and-seek. She found me and jerked my arm and told me she can't wait to get rid of me. She said Pennyweather told her you and me were being called up on Friday." "That's tomorrow. Some families are coming to get boys." Mike sucked in his breath. "We're getting fostered out?" "If they like us. What if Pennyweather tries to separate us again?" "Oh, I told you before," said Mike. "We're not supposed to be separated. Remember? You and me, we stick together." Mike held up a fist. Frankie did the same, tapping Mike's. "Yeah, you and me, we stick together." Mike helped him up. You better go before Mrs. Delancey wakes up again. How are you getting back into your building?
My buddy James is waiting at a window for me.
Mike lifted Frankie to the sill so he could climb down. He looked across at the Lowers' building, which housed the boys, who were 5 to 9 years old. It was a replica of the Uppers, a mammoth brick fortress with intricate herringbone borders around each door and window. Some might consider them handsome buildings, but Mike couldn't say much, since about a place that felt more like a kennel than a home. They had been at Bishop's a little over 5 months, which was nothing compared to how long most of the boys had been there. Weekdays, they were supposed to go to school. But since the 1st of May, schooling had gone by the wayside for working on neighboring farms. Mike would rather have been in class, and Frankie needed more teaching. He could barely read. Mike paced in the stairwell until he heard the whistle that meant Frankie was safely on the ground. He hurried to the window and watched him dash across the walkway and knock on a ground floor window. It opened, and James helped Frankie inside. Mike shook his head, amazed. The kid already had more friends here than he could count. Mike couldn't claim one. But that was fine with him. None of the Uppers ever bothered him because of his size. But they didn't include him either. He couldn't blame him. He wasn't good at sports. Kept to himself, and as much as he tried, he couldn't help his seriousness. He promised Granny he'd look out for Frankie and take care of him. That responsibility had become another layer of skin. Just when he thought he might shed a little, or breathe easy, or even laugh out loud, it tightened over him. In every situation, Mike wondered first what could go wrong, and second, how he would protect Frankie if it did. Mike quietly crept back into his dorm room. Mouse was sprawled across the space next to him. He was older and taller than Mike, and didn't fit well on the cot. Mike carefully stepped around him and climbed onto his own thin mattress. In the gray light, he lay back and stared at the wrinkles of old paint in the ceiling. Maybe the people coming tomorrow would be the answer to getting out of this place. Maybe they even had a piano. Mike rubbed his forehead. Much as it pained him to imagine it, he'd forego the piano if they were decent folks and he and Frankie could stay together. Then again, what if he and Frankie were fostered out to someone mean to the bone? There was always so much that could go wrong.